You're listening to the audio production of Cold Case Christianity, updated and expanded edition. A homicide detective investigates the claims of the Gospels by J. Warner Wallace, published by David C. Cook. This book is read by the author. Case files. Case notes. Detectives become copious note takers, collecting information and documenting their progress along the way. You can use this URL to access the notes referring to the materials cited in each chapter. www.coldcasechristianity.com/casenotes. Special thanks. My deepest thanks to the readers who made the original version of Cold Case Christianity a must-read classic Christian book. I've reviewed every word of the original text, making several important additions and adding a new afterword to the original manuscript. I've also reillustrated the book and redesigned the interior layout. When I wrote the first edition 10 years ago, I was humbled by those who offered support and wisdom. I continue to be grateful to Sean McDowell for motivating me to write the book and for being a true brother in the faith, to Craig Hazen for being the most enthusiastic encourager and connecting me to the people who made the book a reality, to Lee Strobel for having the heart and desire to support the work, and to my literary agent, Mark Sweeney, who took a chance on a cold case detective and has been answering every phone call since. This updated 10th anniversary edition of Cold Case Christianity is dedicated to my best friend, my most trusted partner, truest inspiration, and smartest critic, my wife, Susie. Thanks for being the first person to read every word and for helping me to be the kind of man who would even dream about writing books. Cold Case Christianity, 10 years later. I wrote Cold Case Christianity during one of my busiest seasons as a cold case detective. It launched a journey as a public speaker, including a small role in the feature film God's Not Dead 2, and provided an opportunity to meet seekers and Christians across the world. Humbling is a word often overused, but it's an appropriate descriptor for this season of my life. God found a way to use a detective with an art degree to make the case to an eager and gracious audience. In the 10 years of public interaction, one question emerges more than any other. Jim, can you share your spiritual testimony? People want to hear my salvation story, the personal events God used to draw me to Himself. Audiences ask this question even after they've heard me make the case publicly or after reading Cold Case Christianity. But this book is my salvation story. It describes, along with God's crime scene and person of interest, the evidential journey I took to become a follower of Jesus. For some, that seems hard to believe. Isn't true faith blind? Can someone come to a saving faith by following evidence? Do we as fallen humans possess the ability to properly reason from evidence and draw a conclusion about God's existence, the reliability of the Bible, or the truth of the resurrection? If we can use evidence to determine Christianity is true, why call it faith? I tackle these important theological questions in my third book, Forensic Faith, but the short answer is this. God used the evidence of the gospel eyewitness accounts to capture and record the truth about Jesus, and I examined this evidence as a skeptical detective and learned the truth about the Savior. I'm not a Christian today because I was raised in the church. I wasn't. I also didn't become a Christian because my childhood friends were Christians. They weren't. I'm not a Christian today because I was searching for God or wanted to know Him. I was happy and content as an atheist. I didn't become a Christian because I wanted to go to heaven or was afraid of hell. I was comfortable with my own mortality. I'm not a Christian because I wanted to change my life. As an atheist, I had a meaningful and fulfilling career, a loving family, an incredible wife, and lots of friends. I'm also not a Christian because it works for me. Life on this side of my decision hasn't always been easy. It's been over 20 years since I first trusted Jesus as Lord and Savior. I still struggle to submit my prideful will and selfish desire. There are times when I think it would be simpler to do it the old way, more expedient or convenient to cut a corner or take a shortcut. There are many occasions when doing the right thing means doing the most difficult thing possible. I'm a Christian today for one reason. Christianity is true. I'm a Christian because I want to live in a way that reflects the truth, even if it's hard, inconvenient, or unpopular. I'm a Christian because my high regard for the truth leaves me no alternative. An inconvenient truth is preferable to a convenient lie. Over the past 10 years, hundreds of thousands of readers have examined the evidence offered in this book and have learned how to become better detectives along the way. Many are now Christians. Make no mistake about it, God first called these readers and softened their skeptical hearts. The Christian evidence then did what it has always done. The evidence demonstrated the truth of the resurrection and the deity of Jesus. To God goes the glory.
Foreword by Lee Strobel. I loved hanging out with homicide detectives. I started my journalism career as a general assignment reporter on the overnight shift at the Chicago Tribune, and that meant covering the frequent murders committed around the city. Crime syndicate hits, gang-related violence, domestic disputes gone awry, robberies that got out of hand. Later, I was assigned to the criminal courts, where I reported on the major homicide trials from around Cook County. All of which meant that I spent a lot of time interviewing and socializing with homicide detectives. I liked them because they were no-nonsense, get-to-the-point people with an uncanny ability to cut through the fog of deception that defendants used to cover their tracks. These street-toughened investigators were seldom fooled by a phony alibi or a flimsy excuse as they systematically unraveled the mysteries that confounded everyone else. They were evidence-driven, and so was I, constantly checking and rechecking my information before publishing my reports for the city to see. Back then, I was an atheist. I thought that faith in God was based on conjecture, wishful thinking, and emotions. In fact, the idea that there might be evidence supporting the existence of God was totally alien to me. And I wasn't alone. J. Warner Wallace is a cold case homicide investigator who also started out as an outspoken spiritual skeptic. He began with the assumption that the supernatural was impossible. Yet, when he diligently applied his skills as a detective, allowing the evidence to take him wherever it would lead, he came to a far different conclusion. Assessing the evidence with razor-like precision, he solved the most important mystery of all time: whether Jesus of Nazareth is the unique Son of God. In his savvy and captivating book, Jim will introduce you to the kinds of tools and techniques that he routinely uses to crack unsolved murders that have long baffled other cops. He will show you how this same analytical thinking can be used to crack the case of a long-ago killing on a cross and the incredible resurrection that followed. It's a fascinating process, with Jim drawing on his quarter-century of police experience to explain how and why the evidence of history decisively tips the scales in favor of Christianity. If you're a spiritual skeptic like Jim and I were for many years, then you'll find this investigative adventure to be an irresistible, eye-opening, and potentially life-changing journey, full of helpful insights and wisdom. Like a good cop, I hope you'll pursue the evidence to the conclusion it ultimately supports. That verdict, in the end, will be yours to reach. If you're a follower of Jesus, then Jim's account will not only bolster your own faith, but it will also sharpen your skills in explaining to others why so many incisive thinkers throughout history have concluded that Christianity is uniquely credible and trustworthy. Undoubtedly, you've seen media stories that have traced how cold case detectives have pieced together an evidential puzzle in order to solve the most perplexing of homicides. Perhaps one of those accounts was based on a case that Jim actually helped crack. But as important as these investigations are, none of them approach the significance of the case that this book tackles. So get ready to shadow Jim as he probes the evidence for faith. You'll find his approach to be compelling, his logic to be sound, and his conclusions to be amply supported. Unravel with him the historical case for Jesus and discover its eternal implications for you and all the people you know. Lee Strobel, www.leestrobel.com, author of The Case for Christ and The Case for Faith.
Preface: The Detective Way. I got the call at about 1 a.m. Detectives who are assigned to the homicide unit also investigate officer-involved shootings, OISs. And all of us on the OIS team were called out for this one. When I arrived at the scene, Officer Mark Walker was standing by his patrol car, talking with the sergeant and waiting for our arrival. I shook his hand, made sure he was ready to talk about the shooting, and began to walk through the events that precipitated our call-out. Mark told me he was working patrol when he saw a man driving down the street, swerving from lane to lane as though he was drunk. He pulled the driver over and approached his car. When he leaned in to talk to the man, he could smell the alcohol on his breath. Mark asked the man to step out from the car, and the driver reluctantly complied. As the man stood outside his car, Mark could see that he was angry and defiant. Mark decided to conduct a quick pat-down search to make sure the irritated driver wasn't carrying any weapons. Mark had no idea the driver was Jacob Stevens, a parolee with a long arrest record in an adjacent city. Jacob had just been released from state prison. He was on parole for an assault charge, and tonight he was carrying a loaded Colt 45 caliber pistol hidden in his waistband. Jacob knew that he would go back to jail if the gun was discovered, and he was determined to stay out of jail. When Mark asked Jacob to turn around so he could conduct the pat-down search, Jacob turned away for a moment, pulled his gun, and then turned back toward Mark, pointing the gun at Mark's chest. "I knew he had the drop on me," Mark explained as he recalled the events. "His gun was already drawn and pointed at me before I could even get my hand on mine." Jacob had no intention of discussing the situation with Mark. He'd already decided he wasn't going back to jail, even if it meant killing this police officer. Jacob pointed his gun at Mark and started to squeeze the trigger. Mark was about to enter the fight of his life, and he was starting off with a distinct disadvantage. He was already seconds behind his opponent. All of us who work in law enforcement understand the importance of wearing our bulletproof vests. When we first became officers, we were trained with these vests, and at some point, most of us were shown how the vests performed in live fire tests. We knew they could stop a bullet, including a 45 round. On this night, Mark would put his vest to the test. I just tensed my stomach muscles and prepared to take the shot as I pulled my gun out of the holster.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.